Good morning, students. In the previous lecture of the hydrocarbons, we discussed about the geometrical isomerism of the alkene compounds. Right? After that, we only discovered the first method of the preparation of the alkene compound from the alkynes. So, in this lecture, we are going to introduce every single possible method of the preparation of alkene, including the last one, as well as we will discuss about the physical properties of the alkenes. So let's begin with the first method of the preparation of alkene compounds that we have already discussed in the previous lecture. So right now we are just going to revise it. Okay. So, from the first method, we can see that alkene is prepared from alkynes. Okay, alkynes are triple bonded compounds, and we have already used alkynes in the preparation of alkanols. But at that time, we added total 4 hydrogens to break the both pi bonds. But right now, we are only going to use 1 mole of hydrogen. And that's why this reaction is partial reduction, because we are using only and only 1 mole of H2, so that among the 2 pi bonds, only 1 pi bond will be broken. So 2 bonds will be remaining, 1 sigma bond and 1 pi bond. So for that control, okay, we have to apply some control over here, because we want to keep 1 pi bond. And for that control, we are going to use pelletized charcoal for the controlled reduction, or you can say partial reduction. We are going to use pelletized charcoal. Okay, palladium as a catalyst, because the hydrogenation reaction always requires the catalyst, platinum, palladium or nickel. That's why pelletized charcoal. Okay, what does charcoal do? What is the work of the charcoal? Charcoal absorbs extra amount of gases. What is the use of charcoal? It absorbs the gases. So, the extra amount of hydrogen will be absorbed by the charcoal. But, there is a catch. If we cannot control the activity of charcoal, all the amount of hydrogen will be absorbed. That is not useful for us. That's why we are going to decrease the absorption rate, or you can say activity of the charcoal, by using some of the sulfur compounds, or you can say quinoline or quinoline. These compounds are poisonous, which will decrease the adsorption of the charcoal, so that enough amount of hydrogen will be there to break up 1 pi bond. Now, this whole process was carried out by the Lindler's named scientist. That's why this particular reagent, pelletized charcoal, is known as the Lindler's reagent. Now, let's talk about the reaction. We have one common alkyne compound where carbon-carbon triple bond is there. We are adding 1 mole of hydrogen. So, 1 pi bond will be removed and both the carbon are going to receive 1 hydrogen, as you can see. Now, what is the important thing over here is, whenever we use Lindler's reagent, or you can say pelletized charcoal, it will always give us cis product. You know the geometrical isomerism now. It will always give us cis product. So, what if we want to gain trans product? We have to use sodium dissolved in the liquid ammonia. Sodium dissolved in liquid ammonia. Sodium dissolved in liquid ammonia. So, instead of Lindler's catalyst or Lindler's reagent, we are going to use sodium dissolved in the liquid ammonia. It will give us trans alkyl. In the sense, both the alkyl group will be on the opposite side. Okay. Now, as we seen in the last lecture, if we use ethyne, it will give us ethene. Ethyne will give us ethene. Now, ethene cannot conduct geometrical isomerism because both the carbon have two hydrogens and their spatial arrangement will be same. That's why no CISO trans isomerism will be there in ethene. That's why we can use either linear free agent or sodium dissolved in the liquid ammonia. As well as propyne will also give us propene. Now, propene do not have any geometrical isomers. That's why we can use easily liquid ammonia with the sodium or Lindler's reagent, palladized charcoal. Geometrical isomerism will begin with bute-2-ene. In the sense, for the preparation of bute-2-ene, we have to use bute-2-ine. So, if we use bute-2-ine with the palladized charcoal or you can say Lindler's reagent, it will give us cis bute-2-ine. And if we use sodium dissolved in the liquid ammonia, it will give us trans bute-2-ine. That we have already discussed in the last lecture. Now, let's talk about the second method of the preparation of alkene compounds. Before we start that, let me tell you one thing. This preparation of alkenes will be the most IP question for the long questions, like 4-marker question and 5-marker questions. This can be asked, a whole portion of the 4 method for the long question in your 11th exam. As well as these reactions are useful for organic conversions of the 12th. For your JEE NEET. So, these concepts are going to be useful. So, keep your every single attention over here. Okay? Now, if any one of the portion has been asked in exam, it will be of 2 or 3 marks. Doesn't matter. So, let's continue with our second method. Preparation from alkyl halides. Preparation of alkenes from alkyl halides. Now, the raw material are same in both the preparations. You can say that in the alkane, we used alkyne as a raw material. Alkyl halide was also used in the raw material for the preparation of alkanols. But there is a different reagent both the times. When we used alkyne in the alkane, we used only platinum, palladium or nickel as a catalyst. But now for the alkene, we used a palladized charcoal or you can say sodium dissolved in the liquid ammonia. So there is a difference in both the reactions. Remember the difference. Likewise, whenever we are going to use alkyl halide, there is a difference of another reagent. When we used alkyl halide for the alkanes, we used zinc with hydrochloric acid. Or you can say in the Wood's reaction, sodium with ether. But right now, for alkyl halide, we are going to use alcohol containing KOH. Or you can say alcohol as a solvent and KOH as a solute. So, our KOH dissolved in the alcohol. Reagent difference is that when we use alkyl halide for the alkanes, we used zinc with hydrochloric acid. But right now, for the alkenes, we are going to use potassium hydroxide or potash dissolved in the alcohol. Why alcohol as a solvent? That should be the question. Why alcohol as a solvent? That should be the question. Because what if we use aqueous solution of KOH? Let's see. CH3CH2X. The same compound is over here. Okay? Hello? Ethane. Okay? Now, what if we use aqueous KOH? What will happen? A substitution reaction will take place. Nucleophilic substitution reaction will take place. In the sense, X minus will be eliminated and OH minus will be added. It will be exchanged. So, we will obtain CH3CH2OH, which is alcohol, or more precisely, ethanol. Look at the difference. Here we are preparing alkene by eliminating. So, this is elimination reaction. This is elimination reaction. And here, substitution happens. So, remember that if by mistake you wrote that aqueous KOH, it will not produce alkene. It will produce alcohol because halogen, which halogens? Fluorine, bromine and iodine will be replaced by hydroxide by nucleophilic substitution reaction. But we do not want that. Otherwise, it will be waste of the reagent. So that instead of water as a solvent, we are going to use alcohol as a solvent. And because of alcohol as a solvent, elimination reaction takes place. Okay, how elimination reaction does occur in this compound? Remember that wherever the functional group is attached, that carbon will be known as an alpha carbon. Suppose halogen is our functional group, then halogen containing carbon will be our alpha carbon, and a beside carbon, next carbon will be known as a beta carbon. The functional group carbon will be alpha carbon and the next carbon will be beta carbon. From here, beta carbon releases hydrogen and alpha carbon releases the halogen. Beta carbon releases the hydrogen, alpha carbon releases the halogen. X minus H plus will produce halogen acid HX. Will produce halogen acid HX. Suppose Cl is there, HCl, Br is there, HBr, I is there, HI. All are halogen acid. One molecule of halogen acid will be eliminated and this carbon becomes minus and this carbon becomes plus. Okay. Suppose you broke this bond. What happens? This carbon becomes positive, halogen becomes negative. Likewise over here. Hydrogen becomes positive and carbon becomes negative. That's why this carbon and this carbon combines and becomes double bond. Over here, hydrogen halogen combines and forms halogen acid HX. HX reacts with the KOH and produces salt plus water. Neutralization reaction. Here, beta carbon releases the hydrogen, that's why it is known as the beta elimination reaction. So, we used haloethane and haloethane will give me ethane. This reaction is removing hydrogen and halogen, that's why it is also known as a dehydrohalogenation reaction. Okay? Now, this clarification has not been given in your text. So remember that alcoholic KOH has been used, not the aqueous KOH. Alcohol as a solvent will be there. It is compulsory to write alcohol over here. Okay. Now, let's talk about the speed of the reaction, rate of the reaction. If we have the iodine, reaction will be the fastest. Bromine will slow down the reaction and chlorine will give the slowest reaction because of the difference in electronegativity. Likewise, order according to the alkyl. If tertiary alkyl is there, reaction will be the fastest. Secondary alkyl is there, it will be slow, and if there is a primary alkali there, reaction will be the slowest. Okay, so primary halo compounds will give the slowest reaction, and tertiary iodide compound will give me the fastest beta elimination reaction. Okay, now a very important concept. What if there is two beta carbon? What if there is two beta carbon available for the reaction? Two beta carbons available for the reaction. For that, we have Zaitsev rule. Has not been given in your textbook again. Look, there is a only primary information has been given in your textbook, not the whole concept. So we are going through the whole concept so that you can understand it perfect. That's why Zaitsev rule. Okay, where we can apply Zaitsev? When there is a more than two beta carbon, more than one beta carbon. Okay, so this is our alpha carbon. Alpha carbon combined with the beta carbon. Okay, and one beta carbon over here. So total two beta carbons are there and one hydrogen over here. Look at this. What will be the name of the compound? 1, 2, 3 and 4 carbons are there. On the second carbon, there is the halogen. So, 2-halobutane will be the name. Okay. Now, this carbon is alpha carbon. This one is beta carbon next. And this is also the next carbon. So, beta. Two beta carbons are available. In the sense, we will obtain two different products. Our first product, alcoholic, KOH. Okay, suppose this beta carbon has been used. So, hydrogen and halogen will be eliminated. It will give us CH3. Okay, halogen is eliminated. So, CH, hydrogen is eliminated. That's why double bonded CH and CH3. One halogen and one hydrogen from this beta carbon has been eliminated. Okay. Name of this compound will be but-2-ene. Okay. Let's talk about our another possibility. Alcoholic KOH. Suppose this first beta carbon has been used. So, double bond will be over here. That's why CH2 double bond CH, CH2, CH3 will be there. Name of this compound will be but-1-ene. Okay. Which one is true? First of all, both of them are true. Both will be produced. But question arises, which one will be in the more amount? There, Zaitsev rule comes into the mark. Okay, what is the Zaitsev rule? It is very complicated. So, I am going to simplify it for you. The side which have more carbon. The side which have more carbon. Will contain the double bond. The side which have more carbon will contain the double bond. So this side have more carbon. Two carbons are there in this side. That's why double bond will be over here. Rather than this one. This has only one carbon. So double bond cannot be over here. So that this product will be up to 81%. This product will be only 19%. That was your Zaitsev rule. They have not discussed this in your syllabus, right? So I have included it. Okay, and that will be the end of your second preparation of alkyne compound by using alkyne halides. Now let's discuss about the third particular method from vicinal dialects. Okay, vicinal means next. Vicinal means next. So both the halogen are on the next carbon. So adjacent carbon contains the halogens. That's why it is called vicinal dialect. Suppose there is a word geminal carbon. Then geminal carbon, geminal dialect means both the halogens are on the one carbon. Both halogen are on the one carbon, then it is geminal dihalide. And if both halogens are on a different beside carbons, then it is vicinal dihalide. It is the easiest method. We are going to only use active zinc metal. Active zinc metal means its surface should be clean. Active zinc metal will absorb the halogen from the compound and literally release the ZnH2. Zn dichloride, zinc dichloride, and it will release alkene. Both the carbon loses the electron, that's why it becomes a double bonded compound. So 1,2 dihaloethane will be converted into ethane. Likewise, 1,2 dihalopropane will be converted into propane. Simply, zinc attracts the halogen more. In this reaction, we are losing halogens. That's why this reaction is known as a dehalogenation reaction also. Dehalogenation reaction, and you can say it is also one type of elimination reaction, not the beta elimination, only elimination. Okay, now let's talk about our fourth method by dehydration of alcohols. By dehydration of alcohols. Now, pay attention, because they have only given this much amount of information in your textbook. This is extra for you. Okay. Dehydration means deficiency of water. What will be the meaning of dehydration? Deficiency of water means we are going to remove water from the alcohols. We are going to remove water from the alcohols simply using the technique of beta elimination. Technique of beta elimination will be used to remove water, and that water will be absorbed by concentrated sulfuric acid. Okay, so for that, our functional group containing carbon will be the alpha carbon, and the next to the alpha will be the beta carbon. Beta carbon loses the hydrogen, alpha carbon loses the functional group. So H and OH release the H2O, will be absorbed by concentrated sulfuric acid. Now, a very important thing over here, the condition. You have to remember the exact temperature of this reaction, 443 Kelvin temperature. Okay, so if we use 443 Kelvin temperature, ethanol will be converted into ethene and water molecule will be absorbed by concentrated sulfuric acid. Now, science is all about what if. What if we decrease the temperature by 30 degrees Celsius? We decrease the temperature. Let's do this. CH3CH2OH and CH3CH2OH. Okay? If we decrease temperature by 30 Kelvin or 30 degrees Celsius, in the sense 413 Kelvin, it will release the H2O, but from two molecules of ethanol. and it will give you ether instead of alkene. That's why temperature is important for you. It will give you ether, means CH3, CH2O, CH2, CH3. Name will be ethoxyethane. Just difference of 30 Kelvin, whole functional group, whole product will be different. That's why, remember the temperature has not been given in your textbook again. So, 443 Kelvin temperature will provide you ethene by beta elimination, or you can say dehydration reaction of alcohols. Okay. Now, ethanol is a primary alcohol. Why primary alcohol? Because alcohol is connected with the carbon, and that carbon is primary because it is only connected to the one carbon. What if we have secondary alcohol? What if we have secondary alcohol? This is also a new concept, has not been given in your textbook. Suppose this is our secondary alcohol, propane 2-ol. Propane 2-ol. This carbon connected to the two carbons, that's why it is secondary carbon, and secondary carbon has OH. So it is secondary alcohol. Whenever you have secondary alcohol, reaction becomes easy. And that's why instead of concentrated sulfuric acid, we can use a phosphoric acid, H3PO. 85% concentrated phosphoric acid and 440 Kelvin temperature. Simply, beta elimination occurs. OH and H will be removed and propene will be there. Suppose we have tertiary alcohol. Tertiary alcohol means carbon connected to the three different carbons. We have 2-methyl propane 2-ol. Reaction will be more easy. That's why only 20% phosphoric acid and 358 Kelvin temperature will do the work. It will release the H2O dehydration occurs and 2-methyl propene will produce. These two reactions do not have any fear of the producing ether. It is only going to occur for the primary alcohols. So that was all about the preparation and the step which you should take carefully for the preparing of alkene. Okay? Now let's talk about the physical properties of alkene. It is quite similar to the alkanes. The first three members of the series are in the gaseous form, in the sense ethene, propene and butene are in the gaseous form. Whereas next 14 compounds are in the liquid form, in the sense 10 to 18 carbon containing compound will be in the liquid state, oily liquids. Whereas more than 18 carbon containing compounds simply will be solids. After that, a special characteristic of ethene. Ethene have a mild sweet smell. Ethene have mild sweet smell. It is colorless. Likewise, alkene and all the other alkenes. But other compounds do not have any type of smell. It is odorless. But ethene have a smell, specific mild sweet smell. Remember that. Remaining all the alkenes are colorless and odorless. They are simply insoluble in water because they are non-polar. But they are more polar compared to the alkenes. Alkenes are more polar compared to the alkanes. Why? That we will discuss in alkyne. Okay? So, alkenes are more polar than alkane, still insoluble in water because they are not enough polar. So that they are soluble in organic solvents. Organic solvents like CCl4, carbon tetrachloride, benzene, C6H6, carbon disulfide, CH2, kerosene, petrol. Like this, all solvents are going to be useful to dissolve the alkenes. After that, likewise the alkene with increasing of atomic mass in every successive member, in of every successive member, CH2 difference is there, so atomic mass increases, surface area increases, boiling point also increases by 20 to 30 Kelvin. Likewise, the alkene. Alkenes are more polar than alkene, that's why they have higher boiling point and melting point compared to alkene. Okay? And as similar property again, as the branch increases, boiling point decreases because surface area also decreases. Okay? So that was all about the physical properties and the preparation of the alkenes. In the next lecture, we are going to discuss about the chemical properties of the alkene. So, as a homework, you have to complete the whole portion of the preparation and the properties, physical properties, for two times in your homework by your own without looking in the textbook. Okay? Thank you so much.